I'm here to defend a group of people that have been maligned for far too long. And I'm talking about gamers and people who like to play games in general. I'm Grandmaster Max Illingworth, and well, I play chess, so as you can see, I'm really into games. But actually, I'm into games other than chess as well, and because I have tried a lot of different games on a somewhat casual level, I feel like I'm in a position to kind of understand some of the, let's say, frustration that some people may have when they see us playing games, or where people just don't understand and think that we're wasting our lives away from doing something that we enjoy. And I want to categorically state that that is not the case. Nowadays, there are more opportunities than ever for people to be able to turn their passion, whatever games they like to play, into a viable career. Take, for example, YouTube that we're on right now. I'm sure you've seen many other channels where people are making a living talking about chess, Fortnite, or what other games come to mind as well. Other very popular games like Minecraft, another example. We look at Twitch streams where there are so many people who are out there streaming their gaming as they're playing, again, whether it's chess or something else, and actually making a really good living from doing what they love. And sometimes it even happens with some games that you would think, oh, those games like are just like yesterday's news. Like I know, for example, one stream that I actually watched, I really greatly enjoy, and actually I learned quite a bit about presenting from this stream, watching this stream so much, is actually an Age of Empires 2 stream. And Age of Empires 2, that's a game that was created in 2001. Who would think that 20 years from now, not only are people playing this game, but there are people who are making a good living actually streaming such a game. So when someone, next time someone tells you that you're wasting your life away because you're playing a game, of course, if you do something too much, like let's say if it completely dominates your life and you don't have any sort of balance, then yes, it can have a very destructive impact. But that's true for anything. If you're completely focused on whatever occupation you're going into, to the point where you're not looking after your health, where you're not really giving any time for important relationships, then yeah, it's going to not have a good outcome for you at the end of the day. But at the same time, it's also important to understand that when it comes to games, that there's actually a lot of things that you can learn from games. And honestly, I attribute a very significant percentage of the skill set and skills that I have to very intentional, deliberate use of playing games. That is where I play a game with the intent of figuring out what is the optimal strategy for me in order to win this game as much as possible, and how can I incorporate those strategies, maybe see some connection between them and life. And it's one thing I've noticed with many grandmasters, actually. I see so many grandmasters say there is zero connection between chess and life. And whenever I hear this, I think, man, have you had your eyes closed your whole life? Like, have you been living under a rock? I mean, no offense, but to me, the connections are just so obvious, especially if you look at the personal skills that you have to develop within yourself and the mindset you have to cultivate in order to get to a grandmaster level. Things like letting go of the result and be able to just completely focus and absorb the position, having that focus and discipline in your training, having that ability to consider different options and to evaluate which one is going to be the best one, the understanding that your opponents are not perfect and finding the way to set the most problems, not say to try find the best move every time per se, but looking for the way to make it as difficult as possible for them to find the best move. Just even the general things like the problem solving, the creativity, chess being one of the rare activities that uses both your left brain and your right brain at the same time. Like that's very unique, something very unique with chess in particular. And I think that once eyes are open to this, like it's hard to unsee how basically improving your chess and going through that journey with an open mind does give you skills that do directly translate into your life. And of course, there are many differences between chess and life as well. For example, life is definitely much more of a collaborative effort, where rather than facing an opponent that we are all out to beat, instead, you know, we're aiming to essentially work together in a harmonious way that is in our best interest and also in the best interest of the people around us as well, especially the people we are aiming to serve as well, be it in business, as an employee, or whatever profession that you choose to involve yourself in. But and even then, you can sort of see the similarities. Like if you look at the chess pieces all 16 chess pieces, they're all working together as a team towards a common objective. And it reminds us of the importance of having the right people in our network, the right people in our team. This is true in chess as well as in life, to be able to achieve our goals and to move further and to go farther in our lives. And obviously that's something I can definitely work on a lot more, because I know there were so many times where I felt misunderstood by the people around me. Even sometimes today it still happens where I feel like, does this person really get me? I'm not really sure. So that's one thing I found, like learning to trust people more and actually work together more with people to help one another. That's something that I can definitely improve a lot. So I understand the similarities between chess and life in theory, but in practice, well, there's always room to improve. Just like with your chess game, there's always new things you can learn, whether you're Magnus Carlsen, whether you're just starting out in chess, or if you're anywhere in between on that spectrum. And you know, it's funny, like I'm sort of getting a little emotional like talking about that, because that question like of trust, like even like trusting in the process of learning and growing, like that's something that like not having that earlier and not try that like cost me a lot in my earlier years. But that's probably a better subject for another video to dive into, the sort of learning how to trust people again. But anyway, going back to the concept of the gaming, well, I think that nothing as well as like, if you look at games, like I'm going to just use the games I've sort of played more often as an example. But even if you look at things like Age of Empires 2, or these sort of like, let's say, real-time strategy games, I guess StarCraft might be a more familiar example to those who are watching. Well, obviously there's a component of not just having the overall strategy and sort of like the macro of, okay, this is the way I want to, you know, build up my economy, manage my resources, manage my unit production, basically research the right technologies in the right order based on a priority. But it's also about being able to do those things as quickly as possible and being able to continually adapt to, you know, to what the opponent is doing as well. So there we can actually see a lot of similarities with chess, that it can teach you some useful skills. And okay, it may not be as obvious a correlation with a game like Age of Empires or StarCraft maybe compared to chess, but I think it's still very legitimate with these kind of esports. We're seeing that it does work your brain in different ways. And if you are open to it, it can give you a different and very refreshing perspective. I know, for example, like with chess grandmasters back, I think in the 1990s, maybe the 2000s, that there was some banks actually that were looking for chess grandmasters to hire as analysts in order to get that different, more analytical perspective of the grandmaster to help them. So you might think, okay, people in the workplace aren't really going to value the skills that I have learned or have developed from, you know, trying out different games, from seeing different lessons play out in these kind of simulations, as it were. But there are two counterpoints I have to that. One, I don't think that's really true. I think that with COVID, times have very much changed, where the different skill sets that people need are definitely changing and evolving. I do think that workplaces that don't keep up with like this sort of these changes are sort of going to be left behind. Like one example I can think of is that now a lot of companies are actually shifting towards a 4-day work week rather than a 5-day work week, because they found it actually got more done from those 4 days of work than you would in the 5 days, just because people were a lot more focused and had a lot more time to kind of refresh and recover as such. So you can see even there that the theory is kind of changing. And also, if let's say people aren't valuing you, well, now with the internet, like the barriers of entry are now completely gone. Like anyone can start a YouTube channel on their passion. Like I know, for example, there was this one guy like who I watch, like there's this game called Settlers of Catan, there's online version. And when he started his channel, I just thought, okay, this is going to be a hobby channel. You know, I love his stuff, but he's not probably going to make big money from it, right? And now like he has so many subscribers, he's actually getting like a decent passive income. Like, well, you proved me wrong, and I'm glad you proved me wrong, because it broadened my understanding of what is possible. That even if your niche is something you think like no one is going to give a damn about this niche and no one's going to watch it, if you love doing it, if you're passionate about it, that's going to show through, and it could be something, you know, you could prove the doubters wrong. And you know, that's always a good feeling. Like I mentioned in some of other videos, like about the importance of just not quitting, that there will be challenges where you think this is too much, I don't know the next step forward. But sounds like all you need to know is just like one small step at a time. Yeah, of course, like if I look at it from my perspective, like I have no idea what it's going to take to get from 1,000 subscribers, or let's say the time requires even less, all the way up to 1 million. But it really doesn't matter. All it matters is like next step, like how do we get this to the next level so that people enjoy the videos, and perhaps more importantly, that I am able to express stuff that I actually enjoy, so I don't get stale and get a terrible burnout and feeling like I sold my soul to the devil. Okay, that was a little dramatic, but you get the idea. So I think also with gaming, like, I want to take another example. It's not limited, let's say, just to, like, say computer games or video games, but even I think we can learn a lot from games that do sort of simulate life in certain ways. For example, like the psychological game of Mafia is one that I've played quite a bit online on different anonymous accounts. And actually, what I found is that it really, a lot, I think my ability of being able to read people and sort of understand things from other people's perspective, all that actually came from my ability of doing that with the game of Mafia. For those who don't know, it's a game where you have a majority, an uninformed majority of townsfolk who are trying to find who the minority, the informed mafia are, because the mafia know who each other are, and they know who the townsfolk are as well, but there are more of the townsfolk, but they don't know who the mafia are, so they have to use their detective skills and a lot of interaction and being able to read people very well in order to figure out who the mafia are and to be able to win the game before the mafia kill all the townsfolk and get the majority. So when you look at that, like, that's already very powerful. Like, it just takes the social dynamics that might be confused by different situations to a very basic and very primal level that allows you to actually analyze, okay, when I communicate in this kind of way, it didn't give me the result I was after. When I communicate in this sort of way, it led to a much better thing. And of course, you might be thinking, oh, Max, like, that's persuasion, or that's like manipulation, like you're learning how to manipulate people. But that's not really the point. The point is that the more you develop any sort of skill, like, the better it's going to get. And, you know, any skill that you do develop, that can be used for good and to not just help you, but to help others as well. I mean, just imagine, like, being able to understand things from other people's perspective, being able to empathize with them, being able to really connect with them and relate to them on some level. Like, those are all incredibly valuable skills. And frankly, I think that if you are an entrepreneur, it's absolutely essential. I even say as an employee also, it's absolutely essential to be able to communicate your ideas in a way in which they're just going to be well received, not just to the betterment of you, but to the betterment of the community around you as well. Like, that's what I believe. So you can see, like, even like taking a psychological game, a game that you might think has no connection with reality, it's actually very powerful. And I think that one reason that my, let's say, brain developed in the way that it did in being able to process information relatively quickly, to be able to very quickly pick up new skills and new ideas, a lot of that just came from the fact that I practiced it so much at such a young age. You know, when your brain is like younger than, when you're younger than 6 years of age, your brain is in a complete beta state where you're just literally absorbing everything without any kind of chatter from the conditioned mind, as it were. And because of that, it allows you just to, whatever it goes in, it's just going to just absorb automatically and very naturally. It is the reason that babies are able to learn languages just by listening to them for a long period of time. So basically, that's like that's the idea. And so I know, I remember, like, playing games like Uno with my with my parents. Actually, I still remember when I won my first game of Uno at, I think, 3 years of age. Might have been 4 years of age, I forgot exactly, but, you know, just having that, it also gave me a lot of confidence, like, oh, I can actually beat adults at these different games when I think about it intellectually and think, okay, how can I play these games better and make better decisions as such. And also, I think as well, like, there was this game I remember, like, Tabula. Like, this one I remember really well because I was basically got to the point where I was able to, like, beat my parents quite consistently at this game. In fact, where it's a game where, like, you have these stones on the board, and when you roll the dice, then the stone, you can move, like, the stone you have on the board a different way. So you can take a stone away and have it move it forward, or you can put a new stone on the board. So while you have the randomization of the dice, like with the game Catan, you also have that sort of ability to basically make the strategic decision to make the best of the hand that you're dealt, which is a really great lesson in life as well, because life really is only 10% what happens to you and 90% how you respond to it. That's a saying I remember what my mum also shared with me when I was quite young, and, well, I guess it rubbed off in some ways. Certainly stopped me, like, blaming things for the most part, which is definitely a good quality to take responsibility as such for your own destiny. So, I've kind of gone in a few different directions. I mean, it's not like I, you know, got all these scholarly articles on these are all the benefits of gaming, but I'm just speaking from my own personal experience that I think that also a really great thing about it is it does really help you to relax very well. Like, I think I mentioned in an earlier video about how when I was playing chess, like, that was kind of my escape from all the problems going on in my life. And I really believe that gaming can be that sort of outlet, both creatively and just sort of emotionally for people as well. And it also is actually a great social one. I know there are a lot of games, like I even mentioned, like Mafia, but certainly other games like more team-based games, which actually is a way to connect with people to make friends from all around the world. And I believe that, you know, that sort of interaction, where we're able to make the most of this online opportunities that we have, well, it exposes to a lot of different cultures. It means that we're therefore a lot more accepting and a lot more understanding of others as a result, especially like if we do intentionally do make that effort to broaden our circle. And I mean, that's certainly very true of the chess community as well. Okay, it's true there have been times where the chess community has definitely not been as supportive of women as they could be as such, where definitely there are areas there that can be improved. But still, even I think aside from that, we can see obviously a lot of cultures coming together, and there is more of this culture of acceptance coming through in the chess world as well. So yeah, that's sort of where my head is at when it comes to gaming. I think that with games, like, it's not something that we should criticize other people for their life choices in general. I mean, I think that, you know, people are going to do the things, you know, that they feel that they enjoy the most and that are in their best interests. And, you know, I think that, you know, the agency should be on them to make that change in their life if they want to. It's not something we should try to force onto others, even if we have the best of intentions. Like, what I find is that most of the time, if you give people advice, like, they're not going to receive it very well in general. Like, it sort of feels uncomfortable. But if they come from the up with the idea from their own experience and their own realization, it tends to lead to a much more powerful impact. There's a little bit of coaching gold just there for the coaches who are watching this video. So that's sort of what I feel like. In conclusion, I think that we shouldn't judge, it would be a mistake to judge people based on, like, the fact that I like to play some game. Now, gaming is a completely legitimate career in different ways. Like, you even have esports organizations signing up players for salaries as such. Like, this is now a big thing. So that's what it's like. If you, there is some game that you enjoy playing, then by all means keep playing it. But the thing, main things to keep in mind, I think, to get the most out of the experience are, A, kind of understand why it is that you are playing it, so that it doesn't become something that's like an addiction and just dominates your life. Because I think that's where a lot of the fear that parents might have when they see a kid's playing games, they're worried that the kids are going to become addicted and just not really have the intentionality in their life to move things forward or to grow substantially as people. But I think that, you know, when you do it intentionally, it's like, okay, I'm playing this game because of this, and this is why it's important to me. Whether it's for relaxation, whether it's because it's something you want to make a career, or whether it's just, you know, maybe some other reason you might have. But it's important to be aware of what that reason is. And I think that the second point that I would share as well, beyond like understanding why it is you're doing it, is to sort of look always for the opportunity for learning within those games. And of course, like, if you're trying to improve that game the way I do when I play games, like, I'm constantly trying to get better at whatever it is that I'm doing at that time, then certainly, like, it sort of will help you to apply to other areas of your life and see, okay, like, maybe I can take some of my skill there and see, okay, maybe I can adapt it to improve my own life. That's actually one thing I did, where when I was thinking, I have no idea what I want to do in my life right now, and that actually happened to me very recently. Like, I have no idea what I want to focus on. Whereas I actually broke down, like, elements of this game, and I thought, okay, if this game was life, and sort of gaming a simulation life, then what? How would it kind of fit in? And I kind of put it all together and thought, okay, this actually makes a bit more sense to me, trying to take some first principles and kind of use a simulation to make sense of the chaos that was going on around me at the time in my own head. So I think that's a sort of important point. Like, when you are gaming, try to look for the learning, like, even if it's just within the game, like, that will be something that you might find the connection start to spread to your life as well. And as always, you know, with all good things, make sure to keep it in moderation as such, that it doesn't, like, completely dominate your life and get out of control. That's the main point. So that's about all I have to share. Do make sure to like this video if you enjoyed it, since you watch all the way in, I'm pretty sure you did. And also subscribe for more of my vlogs like this. Take care and happy gaming. Get out of here.